The Earth just keeps getting hotter, and so far, humanity just isn't doing enough to stop it. But a new plan may provide us an answer. If we can't stop releasing chemicals that make the Earth warmer, why don't we just release chemicals that make it colder? Let's talk about that. As a scientist, I can tell you, when we get bored, we usually just sit around and think up cool things we could do. So this plan shouldn't be the least bit surprising. Atmospheric scientists, you know, the ones who study the atmosphere, have come up with a plan to cool the Earth. And the plan wouldn't just be doable, it's also surprisingly cheap. The basic concept is to develop jets that could fly high into the atmosphere and start releasing chemicals that scientists think would reflect solar rays, thus cooling the planet. This cooling wouldn't reverse climate change. The greenhouse gases we emit in mass, like CO2, would still be in the atmosphere. And even without the warming, there's still plenty of downsides to having these higher concentrations of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. If you want us to make a separate video on that, let us know in the comment section down below. This concept is called stratospheric aerosol injection, and according to researchers out of Harvard and Yale, this might be our best hope to mitigate the worst effects of climate change. While this idea does sound a bit crazy, we do have historical evidence that it would work. During particularly strong volcanic eruptions, metric tons of ash are shot into the stratosphere, where air currents can keep the smallest particles floating for years at a time. The most famous example was the 1815 eruption of Mount Tambora on the small Indonesian island of Sumbawa. The eruption directly killed tens of thousands on the island and expelled as much as 150 cubic kilometers of ash and rock into the air. Since you probably have no reference for just how much ash that is, that would be enough to fill the New York Giants Stadium more than 80,000 times. But even more important than the ash was 60 megatons of sulfur released into the atmosphere. The following year would be known as the Year Without Summer, as global temperatures fell by 1 degree Celsius, and nearly 100,000 people died of starvation as crop yields suffered around the globe. It wasn't until more than a century later that scientists realized it was that sulfur, rather than all the ash, that had cooled the planet. It turns out that the sulfur dioxide a volcano shoots high into the air combines with water vapor to form sulfuric acid, which quickly condenses into tiny droplets that can float along with air currents. And while most volcanic ash falls out of the stratosphere within a few days to weeks, these drops of sulfuric acid can stay airborne for months to years at a time. As winds carry these aerosols around the Earth, they absorb solar energy and radiate it back out towards space, which cools the Earth's surface below. Those researchers found that humanity could, using a similar method, cut the effects of humans' annual contribution to the greenhouse effect in half. Development would cost about $3.5 billion over the course of the next 15 years, mostly going to designing planes capable of carrying heavy tanks of aerosol spray high into the atmosphere, about double the cruising altitude of a Boeing 747. Once the tech is ready, the researchers found the project would cost about $2 billion a year, assuming the project ran for 15 years. So that's a total cost of $37 billion for the entire planet spread over 30 years, so it really isn't very much. Sulfur dioxide is actually really cheap, and there's lots of it available. Most of these post-development costs would just come from flying the SO2 high enough that it would stick around. Just as a cost comparison, in the next few years, Texas will have spent nearly $1 billion replacing a single bridge in Corpus Christi. New York City's yearly subway budgets routinely run into the tens of billions of dollars, and the US Air Force buys planes that, individually, cost more than $2 billion each. By the way, if you're wondering why we have to fly it high into the stratosphere and can't just pump it out of factories down here on the ground, that's because if you deploy it at 35,000 feet, say where current 737s fly, it rains back down in a few days because it's just being acted on by gravity. But if you get it high into the stratosphere, it can stay a breeze for much longer as it gets carried by air currents. But you might be wondering, wait, we release tons of CO2 down here on the ground. How come that doesn't fall out of the atmosphere just like the sulfur would? Well, that's because CO2, unlike sulfates, can last for thousands of years in the atmosphere. So, is all this a good idea? Is this the one-stop solution for climate change that we've been waiting for? Well, like we said at the start of the video, cooling down the planet isn't the same thing as reversing climate change. Carbon emissions do a lot more than just heat the planet. For starters, they make oceans more acidic, which endangers thousands of species and alters the global movement of water and air. So farmlands that have historically got plenty of rain could find themselves with frequent droughts. But there's still a very real reason to cool the Earth, besides just for human comfort. And it's the tipping point, after which this plan would no longer work. Today, about 40% of the world's population lives within 60 miles of the coast, and more than 300 million people live less than 10 feet above sea level. It's estimated that sea levels will rise by nearly a meter by 2100, putting hundreds of millions of people in jeopardy. Most of this rise comes from the melting of land-based ice, like in glaciers. I always used to assume that water just kind of froze into glaciers, and when it got hot, some melted. But glaciers actually form from millions of years of snowfall compacting into ice. This means once ice sheets melt, they'd never refreeze on human timescales. Once too many glaciers melt, cooling the Earth wouldn't be able to combat sea level rise, and with glacial melt increasing year after year, we're running out of time to act. So, is this technology the future? Well, right now it looks significantly cheaper than alternative geoengineering technologies. If you want to learn more about how scientists are trying to pull CO2 out of the air, be sure to check out our video on that after this one. But even if humanity decided to aggressively cut CO2 emissions, which at least for now, it doesn't look like that will be the case, it would still take time to reduce emissions, and so we could end up being stuck with this as one of our only options left. If you like learning about this topic, and let's be real, who doesn't like learning new things? Be sure to drop a like and a comment down below. It really does help us smaller channels in the YouTube algorithm, which lets us provide more free content for you all. And be sure to subscribe so you never miss an upload. As always, have a great day. And remember, there is always more to learn.